Here we are. I'm Rishabh Srinivas. So we are from India. We work for an organization called Systango. It's basically into IT solutioning. Our topic here today is learn guitar via Python programming. It's kind of fun. Like, I want to know how many of you ever tried to play your favorite song over a guitar and you gave up just because it was too difficult. Anyone?
One.
No one. Okay. So our journey is somewhat like this, because generally what people try is they go over YouTube, try to watch some videos, do some lessons by an instructor, and then they give up because it's too tedious. So this was the problem that we were given to solve, and we build our solution based upon this problem. Okay, so before we move forward, I would like to cover all the pointers that we are going to cover in this session. Like, we are going to give you some music basics, because that's an elementary part where guitar comes in, and how to parse MIDI using Python. And then we are going to present a case study that is of a guitar, like how we used MIDI to extract guitar tablatures and how we use that for our problem solving. Now let's define the problem in more detail. Like, generally what we see is guitar is a difficult instrument to learn. Like, it's the perception of that instrument is quite difficult, and it's generally the case with most of the musical instrument. What the common problem is, like, people generally want to learn the things quite quickly. Like, they want results quick, and they are able to do so because they start with music theory, then they get too much dwelled into the subject, and then they don't get the results as expected because they lack a proper audiovisual model for that. So our problem was that only, because once there is a good audiovisual model, it gives a good feedback mechanism they can easily learn and retain whatever they have learned. So there's a bit of story behind this whole thing, as our case study goes. So there were three actors in this. Like, the idea was to build a retainable representation of the guitar, and since we are from Systango, and we had a technical partnership with the HTEC Labs, which is a US-based company, and they mostly delve into IoT products. And they wanted to build a product called Fred's Alert. And the idea was to have a, like, kind of look like. It's basically what you can attach this thing to your guitar, and basically it lights up the correct frets and strings representation so that you can generate the songs. So this was the problem that we were given to solve. Before we proceed further, I would like Srinivas to explain some guitar terminologies so that we can, you know, go through the journey. So this is a guitar.
May I please get a pointer?
Pointer?
No. These are
okay.
No?
Okay. No problem. Yeah, that's what I use. So as you can see, that this is a guitar. The most important parts that we are concerned about are strings, which are these thin wire kind of things that you see over here, and these bars, which are called frets. I mean, this space, it is called a fret. So what happens is that on a string, if you press a fret, you hear a sound and intonation. If you press a different fret, you hear a different kind of intonation. That's how guitar is played. And if you do not press any fret at all, you get a different intonation. If you do not press a fret, that position or that state of guitar is called open string. So the open strings also need to have some kind of a default frequency kind of thing set to them for each string. So for a six string guitar, or for, I mean, the combination for all these strings, the frequency for each open string, it is called tuning, the default frequency for everything. So the most common tuning is called standard tuning. So we'll cover that later. I mean, what all are the consistent consistence of the tuning, and what are notes and other musical terminologies. So let's learn about some musical terms. Let's talk about the musical note. What is a musical note? If you hear a single frequency of sound that is constant, I mean just a single frequency, nothing else, just a single waveform, if you talk in terms of audio, that is note. If a combination of multiple notes is heard, then that is a chord. You can play multiple notes together to make some musical sense out of it, to make a melody out of it. That is known as a chord. Scale is a collection of notes that can consist a baseline of a song. This means that a song actually, there is a definitive collection of notes. Like if you say that, if you talk about the C major scale, I'll come to that what it means, but its consistent notes are C, D, E, F, G, A, B. So there are many songs that actually are based, or they start off, or the C, D, E, F, G, A, B are most common notes in that song. So which is why a scale is most useful for. How many fans of EDM? Okay, great. So you hear the thumping music, the pulses, boom, boom, right? So each pulse is called a beat. And the speed of those beats is called tempo. Now, the unit of tempo is BPM, beats per minute. This is how it's measured. Bar. Bar is also known as a measure. It consists of a fixed number of beats. It is like grouping the song and distributing it in groups of beats. Like four beats make up a bar, so that whenever you actually play music or you listen to music, you can actually understand, okay, that one measure is complete, one bar is complete, now we can come to the next bar, and next bar would actually hold some different kind of notes. So all of this combines to become music. So Rishabh would explain what is a transcriber.
Yeah, so
Representation like this, in which you can have tablatures represented on the guitar fretboard. But the underlying thing was we wanted sound feedback as well. Like the audio thing was missing in the tablatures that are there in the market, because you can easily download tablatures. They actually will show you where to put your finger on the guitar, but you don't know when. That's the bigger problem. So we developed this transcriber, which will actually translate the audio files into this guitar tablature, which will actually tell the keeper what sound to hear and what to do on that sound. Okay, and moving on, we wanted some good audio feedback, and MIDI was our sole contender, because MIDI is the most widely used digital format for representation of the sound files. And it's really abundant, and it is one of the most old file format, which is used for this, and it generates good tablature, and we use that for generation of time tablatures. Okay, now how we use Python to our aid. First and foremost thing, like we wanted some file processing. So as we all know, Python has provided us with good file IO mechanisms, so that was a great aid to our cause. Apart from that, there are good libraries like MIDI and Music 21, which we have used extensively, and we are going to do some demos about that as well, like how we use that and to represent MIDI as an object and do some stuff on it. And thirdly, like for the whole algorithm reduction, we wanted to do some mathematical computations, and for that, NumPy and Cypher were like a blessing for us. And after all, since this was an experimental kind of thing, we needed a lot of changes and stuff. So IPython and Jupyter were like a blessing. Moving on, BD would explain version.
So before we move on, how many of you know what are guitar tabs or tablatures? Okay, quite a few of you. For the rest of you, let me move back a couple of slides. So this is how a tablature looks like. Okay. So as I told you, these horizontal lines I guess all of you must recall the anatomy of the guitar that I showed you earlier. What are strings and what are frets? So these horizontal lines, they represent strings. And these numbers over here, they represent frets. So if this position, I mean, if it is like E0, then what it could look like on a real guitar is, so if we talk about E0, E0 is this. I mean, no fret is pressed. Zero is when no fret is pressed. The fret counting starts from number one. If you talk about E3, then here, this is where you press the string in order to hear a different sound. So that's how tablatures are read. So now let's talk about MIDI. MIDI stands for Musical Instrument Digital Interface. It is not only a format, but before becoming a format, it is most like a standardization of transferring musical signals to controllers or receivers that can parse it and produce output. So this consists a lot of things. A MIDI standardization consists of protocols, consists of standards over pins, over cables that are used to transmit data. So let's talk about MIDI files, because this is what our case study covers. We convert a MIDI file directly into guitar tablatures. So a MIDI file consists of MIDI messages. So what is a MIDI message? It is basically a signal or a digital signal in which various attributes are kept over and are sent to a controller, so that the controller can read those attributes and then provide output accordingly. So this is what a MIDI message means. So the type of data that are transmitted over MIDI messages are musical notes, musical instruments, the time signature for the song, and the difference between, that is delta between two MIDI messages. So I'll tell you why all of these are required and why we should learn all of this in order to proceed with parsing MIDI. Yeah, regarding time is measured in ticks. So ticks is not something, not a unit that we are quite familiar with. Ticks, I mean, most of us have heard seconds, milliseconds, microseconds and all. So of course, I'll explain how to convert ticks into milliseconds further on. So these are the libraries that we used. We would like to accredit their authors fully. They actually helped us save our day, and we helped us arrive at the transcriber that we built. So, attributes of MIDI messages and events. So, as I told you, MIDI files had an attribute. I mean, MIDI messages, the type of data that MIDI messages could carry was quite different. Now, in our context, how does it all fit in? So if we were to read a MIDI message, or if we were to make sense out of the data that it provided, then these are the things: note, time, channel, and velocity. Note, as I told you, it's the musical note that we hear, and it is represented as a number instead of the name like C, D, E, F, G. So this is a different thing in terms of MIDI. Time, of course, we just spoke about. Time is measured in ticks for each message that is sent. Channel. Well, the concept of channel is that if you have a single MIDI connection, then it supports up to 16 channels. It is a literal channel. I mean, one that actually supports, that transmits a stream of data. So it is up to controller to either listen to or ignore a channel. But of course, we will talk about that later. Velocity. Velocity is the volume of a MIDI message from which you can actually hear a note. So this is just like a volume controller. Now let's get into some coding. So MIDO is the library that helped us the most. So from as you can see, this is the MIDO package. It has the MIDI file class, and parsing a file is real easy. Like, you just pass in the MIDI file to the MIDI file, the actual MIDI file to the MIDI file class, the construct, its constructor, and you actually have an object. Now, when you the tracks is one of the attributes of this object. So, what is a track? Track is, for example, a song has drums, guitars, vocals, keyboards, everything. So all of these are mixed and a song is created. All of these are recorded individually and a song is created. So these individual recordings, they are known as a track. So as you can see, there are a lot of tracks. Melody, harmonica, acoustic guitar. The song is Stairway to Heaven. I don't know how many of you have heard it, but it's a great song by Led Zeppelin. So, so as you can see, there are a lot of tracks. Like acoustic guitar, melody, harmonica, and recorders, and everything. So all of these are played at well-assigned time for each kind of message within each track. So all of these tracks, what do they consist of? They consist of MIDI messages. Now let's see how a MIDI message it looks like. So I this is a snapshot. I actually I bifurcated a track and I saw what's inside a track. So this is within the acoustic guitar track. So as you can see, there are various kinds of messages. There are meta messages, like for this one, what it does, it just sets the track name. Now program change message, what it does is that program change is one of the MIDI, standard MIDI messages that MIDI allows. It sets the instrument, whatever instrument is being played. So if you see, here you can see the program attribute is it's 24. So all the guitar instruments are ranged from 24 to 31. The program numbers for guitar are 24 to 31. Now, as you can see here, this is a note on message. What note on means that a note is being played. It can be heard whenever a controller parses it or whenever a controller receives it. The controller will play it back to you. The controller can be anything, right from mobile app to a real keyboard. You just need to hear a MIDI message and then produce the output. Note off means if a note is playing during note on, and if you want to turn it off, you simply send the note off message, and the note turns off. So this is a summary of the MIDI messages, but the most important part, what we required is this note attribute, only for note on events, mind you. So if it says that this note is number 57, when it translates to real musical notes, it means a different note. It's the A note, by the way, but yeah, we'll come to that later. So these note numbers are essential for us in order to proceed and in order to arrive at an algorithm that can actually calculate guitar tablatures right from MIDI. Yeah, so as we spoke earlier, time is measured in ticks, but we have a nice formula that converts beats per minute into time elapsed in milliseconds. This PPQ attribute, it's pulses per quarter note, or the number of ticks, MIDI ticks, that are elapsed within the time span of two beats. That is pulses per quarter note. So MIDO actually provides us this by default. I mean, it calculates for us readily, and this is how we can obtain pulses per quarter note. Now, these are the musical notes that we wanted to talk about. Now, this is the standard notes. I mean, whenever you go to learn music, everybody would tell you that these are the notes that you can learn, and they consist of most of the music that you hear of. So these musical notes are represented as a number in MIDI. How does it fit in over here? So if C has the number 0 in MIDI, these notes C sharp, D, D sharp, E, they would have numbers like 1, 2, 3, 4, and so on. I mean, it's sequential in MIDI. Everything is serial. And of course, the most important part, these notes can be arranged in the form of matrix. Now, if you remember the string and fret arrangement of a guitar, let me show you. So there might be six strings
over here, and these are all different frets. Each of a string fret combination can be treated as a coordinate, which can actually host the MIDI note, which resides over here, for a given tuning, of course. So, yeah, this is something, I mean, you can perceive notes in terms of numbers. This is how actually the MIDI notes translate into MIDI notes. And for guitar, the actual notes would look something like this. It's a representation for the actual guitar. For standard tuning, of course, this would change if the tuning would change. Like the bass frequencies for all the strings, if that's changed, then this would also change. In terms of MIDI, this is what we have for a 24 fret guitar. This is a simple NumPy matrix in which we started from number 40, because in standard tuning for the E note in the second octave, the MIDI note, the MIDI number that is significant, that signifies this, is number 40. So this is the matrix, and this is how the story of the transcriber begins. Now Rishabh would go on to explain challenges.
Yeah, sure. So if you go back to this matrix, you can see like the MIDI is just having note numbers like 57, 62, 64, and so on and so forth. But if you see in this matrix, we had like multiple occurrences of these numbers. So this was one of the major challenges that we had to face. Like we cannot easily translate, even if we were considering this matrix as our guitar, like each row is going to represent the string of the guitar, and each column is going to be the fret of the guitar. Okay, so due to multiple occurrences of these numbers, it was quite difficult for us to, you know, find the optimal string fret location for any song that was being transcribed by our code base. So what we had to do, we had to think of some good ideas which would, you know, find the best or the actual part that was, you know, played by the artist who was performing that song. And our aim was to do this in pretty quickly, because we did not want to hamper the user experience. Like they upload the song, it gets processed and comes back. Okay, so for this we went through a lot of phases. Like our code algorithm evolved. Like we have like 6 version out now, but it's still work in progress. But I'll tell you, for the first 2 versions were not so significant because they were not producing the output as we wanted. But V3 was quite significant for us because this algorithm was actually taking all the MIDI data, computing notes as in they were from our note matrix, and we were building a path out of it and showing things over the guitar. But I think the only problem with this thing was because it was not considering the actual song transitions that were happening. Like Srinivas explained, like how the bar works, how the measure works. If the song is fast, the measure changes, and so on and so forth. So that's why we went over to V4, that was bar isolation. So in this, we tried to, you know, process all the notes, all the messages which were there, combined in a bar, and we isolated them and then tried to produce result. It was a bit of improvement over V3, but there was still something missing. Like we were still not processing the notes and chords combined, and that was the major groundbreaking thing that we did in V5. We were actually combining the notes and chords separately and processing the chords as if they were played alone and notes separately. So by this only we were able to get good transition results and near actual path. And finally, where we are now right now, because in V6, that is work in progress, we are actually trying to find the actual starting point of the guitar. That comes via scale detection, because as Srinivas explained about scales, like once you find the scale of the guitar, you actually get the key of the song. And once the key is obtained, you can actually find the starting point of the guitar fret locations. And then you can proceed forward with your, you know, tablature generation and so on and so forth. So our goal was like to we produced some output like this. I'll explain you like what this output stand for. So this is one instance like how we perceived things, and we wanted this thing to be like time, because we wanted to build an event driven system and things to happen at particular time. So what this says is at 340 milliseconds, note 60 is to be played from the audio output with the amplitude of 90. It's a note on, so it would be played, and we computed these two things, like string and fret. This was the output that we generated. Obviously, there were other solutions as well which were solving these problem, and I think most significant of these were like Tuck's guitar, which was like its sole purpose is not to solve the generate the tablatures out of a MIDI file, but it's more of a MIDI editor. So it was not so accurate as it had to be. And there were many research papers also over here in this region, but the problem with those was they were like I would say like not practically too feasible to implement for a production based server. So here is the comparisons that we found, like Tuck's guitar and our transcriber and the research papers that were there. You can have a look, like what was the major assessment criteria was the processing cost and the accuracy. So we were not computing like taking too much of processing cost, and we were generating good accurate result, and I guess we were able to attain like 75% of the actual tabs. So this is the comparison of the actual tabs of the Stairway to Heaven. Like this is the actual tab, the one in the white, and this is the one which is like we transcribed. And if you see, like these are the first 20 MIDI notes that were processed, and we were able to get 75% of the actual track that was played by Jimmy Page. And Srinivas, can you please demo?
Yeah, sure.
We are going to now start a demo about the of our app, and
GitHub, this is it.
Yeah, basically, I tried using an extension.
That's okay, in show the app.
No problem. I'll demo the app instead.
Okay, so please look at the app.
This is a mobile app that actually parses all the data that is generated by our transcriber and plays it back in the form of tablature. And whatever it plays in the form of tablatures would be visible over here. So basically, the concept of this whole LED lighting is that it would attach over your guitar, and wherever the lights are illuminated, you just need to press those strings and frets, and you would be actually able to play whatever song you like. So let's do it for Stairway to Heaven. Let me turn on the volume to full. Okay. So that's what we achieved through this
transcriber. Yeah.
The transcriber gave all the data that could be parsed, that could be not only displayed, but also could be played as audio.
Yeah.
And displayed here as well over the hardware.
Yeah. And this was all possible because of the MIDI magic. And here we like to conclude, like our special thanks to the MIDI and Music 21 creators, how they helped us. And what we foresee where the MIDI can be, you know, essentially used in many educational softwares can be built out of this, like Fred Zillet is built, and it can be easily used in any gaming domain that can be there. So here we end our presentation. Please reach out to us if you have any queries. Here are our email addresses. Any queries if you have.
Any questions? Yeah.
How does the program decide which guitar string to display the note? Is it optimized to minimize switching of fingering positioning? Because you can play it in just in one string, right? But if there's a way to like optimize it, like leverage the six strings, how does it currently
well,
decide?
It totally depends on you, on how you would like to do it. Every guitarist has their own style.
Yeah.
And if one has to generalize it, it is very difficult to generalize something. So what we aim at is, we actually aim at obtaining the result of the tablatures that are already existing in the market.
Okay.
So we try to attain results close to what they have.
Yeah.
Because the MIDI doesn't have a fret or...
That's where algorithm kicks in.
Oh, so that's there.
Yep.
The algorithm is proprietary?
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, sure.
I think this is a very interesting project. And
thank you.
Maybe there might be some possibilities to apply like compiler optimization techniques when you optimize the fingering after transcription. So yeah, I think that might be a very interesting extension. And also, I think making a real rhythm games will be very interesting.
Like Rocksmith, so, you mean?
Yeah.
Something like Rocksmith that exists?
Of,
with
real guitar.
Yeah.
Yes.
So this trip actually can be pasted on a real guitar.
This can be applied to a real guitar.
Yeah.
So that you can play everything that is displayed over here in real time.
Yeah, sure.
That's
So currently you showed us the format of the output, right? With I think in JSON format.
Yeah, it was JSON.
Do you have any plans to like support other formats? Like let's say Tax Guitar, I can open a GP like Guitar Pro format.
Yeah.
So at least it's can open it on another.
Yeah. So
other challenges.
So GP files also we are trying to we have kind of it's our next goal to include in our project as well. Like we have like a beta out for GP. And we think it's a really good format, but the one thing that GP has is it has manual input of the string fret location. So suppose you are totally reliable on the like GP to be manually translated by someone and filled with that information.
Yeah.
And we wanted that it should be automated.
Yes,
that was the main thing, like solving this problem.
This could as well be there in future because Python has a very good Guitar Pro package out there.
Mm-hmm.
So yes, this is definitely in one of our plans in order to include GP. Do you have any specific formats that you would like to be included? I mean,
Tax Guitar.
Okay.
TG.
Yeah, TG format.
Because
of course.
Open source and
of course.
I got another, but
anyone else?
Anyone else? Any other questions?
Sure.
Yeah, you can go.
Okay, so a while ago you were sharing on the like issues like say in Tax Guitar, right? And then the corresponding papers that being done. Are you able to share like what paper? So at least after this session, we can sort of research further.
We can talk about that later. Sure.
Cool.
Yeah. Could this be expanded to other string instruments or even keyboard instruments?
Yeah, so your question is to add more instruments to this?
Yeah,
yeah, so currently, like Fred Zillet, they are aiming to add bass guitar as well. And
ukulele and banjo as well this year.
Because the note matrix that we prepared, you saw that. Because it can be it's literal translation of MIDI data on the guitar. And same concept can be applied to anything. Like, see this.
This one.
So, this is a like 6x24.
Yes, this is 6x24.
For bass, it would be 4x24.
So of course, wherein the challenge that you mentioned, it of course stems from the fact that if we have something like a MIDI note number 57, so it repeats on many places over the matrix. It is here, it is here, and it is somewhere here as well.
Yeah.
So which 57 do you choose? Yeah. That is where the algorithm does the trick.
Yeah.
So this is the mostly for string instruments, right?
For now, yes.
Yeah. For now, for sure.
So you have the information in the MIDI file for all
yeah. all the instruments. Yes.
Yeah. So it's possible to actually deduce.
Yeah, MIDI has a lot of information, and the best part about that is it's just in KBs. Yeah.
Yeah. Sure. Please.
Do you have any plans to extend this algorithm to other instruments, for example, piano or?
We'll think. Like first, we want to master. Like I as mentioned, like we are work in progress. So once we master the guitar and the string domain, then we definitely would like to extend this to other instrument.
Yeah, piano would be much easier.
So question: let's say I never play guitar mm-hmm. and I wanted to play, but then how we control so that I can play?
Yep. So that thing that we showed in that demo, you can actually control the speed.
Oh.
So yeah, it can be slower.
Yeah, I mean, the speed at which this was played was a normal speed, but yes, you can slow it down, like
0.2x, 0.5.
This is 0.5. So this is certainly doable.
Yeah, and for learners, this is the best thing.
Yeah, also the app is free over the market for both iOS and Android.
What about the hardware?
It's not. Yeah, sure.
Usually for when we do the hardware and then music, when we sync the thing, right? So usually for musicians, we have this lag time challenge. But for this, let's say if you want to play like Malmsteen tracks, mm-hmm. like mm-hmm. very fast, how's the lag time like?
So like you just want to do a light show or something, or
yeah. So is
that, no, the lag time is if you talk about lag times, yes, we experience certain lags because the performance, because this is still a work in progress. So there is a definite room for improvement over the performance of the apps, but we still have a reasonable lag time. Let me show it to you. I mean, we have a huge collection of songs, so. If you know Malmsteen, you sure must know about Buckethead.
Ah, okay.
Okay.
Maybe the internet is bad.
Actually, I'm not receiving.
You talk about
okay,
this.
No, right. Yeah.
Yeah. Anyone else has questions?
So, we also have, I mean, if I'm not mistaken, Mean has Mean Star. Xiaomi Mean.
Okay, okay.
So, but. The price is quite high, so how much do you guys plan?
So actually this hardware is proprietary of EdgeTech Labs. We were in the mostly in the solutioning part of this. Like as far as they are concerned, this is available for at least $200 in the whole on the whole earth.
On worldwide basis.
Yeah. And they plan to release a smaller version for this as well.
I think there was, in your next version, you'll be working on reducing the scale at which this is being played.
Yeah.
That's right.
How do you plan to do it?
We have a very good library called Music 21, mm-hmm. written by Professor Michael Scott Cuthbert. He's from MIT. And his library does all that magic. He already has, although there are different algorithms for doing that, the most famous algorithm for deducing a scale, a musical scale, is called Crumb-Hansen's algorithm. So there are many other algorithms which can be implemented to find the scale. So that is not something that is very difficult. So we also have ready-made solutioning to obtain the scale for a given song.
Yeah. Yeah. I think that's it. So thank you for your time.
Thanks a lot, everyone.
Nice.